we are delighted to be here. We are part of the Stanford University StarTalk programs. We have both a student program and a teacher program. We've been at this business for 10 years. Ying's been there since day one. We have somebody in the audience who was there day one as a participant, so welcome. And Claire joined us about 4 years ago. We have done elementary programs, we have done middle school programs, and we've done high school programs. And we've enjoyed every aspect of our programs, and we have met a unique need of the needs of our language learning community with the districts that we have partnered with. Right now, our program this year and for the past 2 years has been a middle school program. And basically, it's part of an initiative with Sunnyvale Unified School District for getting their middle schoolers ready in the summer to go either into middle school or into high school and have a successful learning experience learning Chinese. Most of our students, most of the participants in our program are Latino students. And they're venturing into learning Chinese. Most of them already have Spanish under their belt, you know, they're heritage speakers. And they have varying degrees of ability, but they come into our program and spend 4 weeks with us, and at the end of the program, they leave as confident learners of Chinese. And that, you know, when they do that, they've met our goal. Some of them end up in the middle school teacher that is also a part of that program. Some of them end up in Ying's class at the high school level. And when we visit them in the fall or talk with them since then, they tell us that the StarTalk program gave them all the confidence and the skills in which they can sort of hit the road running in the fall and begin to learn Chinese. I have to tell you that collaborating with these two young ladies has been the joy of my life, and this is probably the reason why I reapply every fall to do another StarTalk program the following summer. Claire Albert is a super immersion teacher in the Ohlone Mandarin Immersion Program. Ohlone is right in the backyard of Stanford, and they've been employing an immersion program for the past 6 years, 7 years?
7 years.
7 years. Very successful program. We've been with that program day one. We have assessed their success, and those students are outperforming their counterparts in math, science, English, language arts, just like what you would expect. And we have learned from French programs and Spanish programs, but we did not know if the same would hold true for Chinese. It does. We have the empirical research behind it. We have done a StarTalk program as a culminating experience for those students at the end of fifth grade. And Claire has led that entire process. Ying Jin has been with us first as a participant and now as a wonderful lead teacher in our middle school and high school programs. She teaches at Cupertino High School and Homestead High School, right in the backyard of Apple Computer. As a matter of fact, they have a partnership with Apple Computer at their school. And she's not only incorporates a lot of technology into her teaching, but she brings a lot of enthusiasm and wonderful strategies into our program. She can keep middle school students motivated all day long. Yesterday at the general session, we spent a little bit of time talking about the growth mindset, right? It was rather quick. You watch a short video of Carol Dweck, who's a member of the psychology faculty at Stanford University. She's a colleague. We've worked a lot with her. The growth mindset that's taken over California schools, everyone is sort of focusing on the growth mindset. We did not spend as much time in the growth mindset as I thought we would in a general session yesterday. So I wanted us to review a little bit here what a growth mindset is. Basically, it's instilling in the students a belief that they can achieve. We also, as you know, language instructors, we need to instill in ourselves the belief that our students can learn the language. And I have to say that sometimes Chinese teachers, Arabic teachers, teachers of the less commonly taught languages, sometimes we believe that it's almost impossible for Anglo or mainstream students to learn the languages we teach. We have to get rid of that belief. Our growth mindset is to really, really believe that all students coming into our programs can acquire the language. if we teach it in a way that will make will resonate with them and will be meaningful to them. But basically, you can see, I think, on both screens here, what a growth mindset is and what a fixed mindset is, right? I'm not going to read each one of those things because you saw Carol Dweck yesterday, but basically a fixed mindset just sort of stops you from achieving your potential. A growth mindset opens up all possibilities for learning and acquiring and engaging, and that's what we want to have in our programs. And that's what these two brilliant teachers do every day, and certainly starting with day one. Those students come in and they instill that belief in those students, and those students leave at the end of the first day already with the attitude, I'm going to succeed in this program. I was able to do everything that they asked me to do today. Of course, it was scaffold, it was carefully planned, everything was purposeful, everything was deliberate, because we did a lot of planning beforehand so the students will have that good experience. Okay, just sort of tapping into prior learner experience here and doing a little bit of review of what a fixed mindset, and I'll go back to the other slide. I want us at our tables to think of a teacher planning, assessing, or teaching action that would be sort of written up or done from a fixed mindset point of view. And I want you to then to change that would reflect a growth mindset. And we're going to be sharing, you know, very briefly here when we do this. So I'm going to take it back. So you're going to think of a planning action when teachers are planning a lesson, that they would have sort of a fixed mindset going about that lesson. For example, believing, my God, my students cannot do this. This is too hard. That would be a fixed mindset. And a growth mindset would be, yeah, let me go ahead and plan this, because if I do this and this and this, the students will be able to do it, because I will scaffold it like that. That is the growth mindset. So either a planning, a teaching, or an assessment, you know, because, you know, oh, let me develop this assessment strategy and let's see if our students can do it. So let's spend about, you know, 3 minutes. You're not going to have a lot of time. At your tables in a group, think of about one of these activities, and then we'll come back and share. Okay? It's your turn. Okay. I think we're about ready to share. I know it's very quickly. It's just getting us, you know, sort of in the review mode. Okay. When you begin to share, when I call on your table to share, can you please identify the, is it an assessment? Is it a teaching? Or is it a planning action? And sort of describe the mindset, the fixed mindset first, and how you change it to a growth mindset. Okay, these tables, ready to share here?
When we're thinking about actions, uh-huh. We were considering the fixed mindset would be, I don't want to bring the idea of that somebody who was successful at a different institution or a school or a classroom would use, because my classroom is different, it's not going to work in my classroom, mm-hmm. I have different kinds of students or planning.
It will never work in my classroom.
Mm-hmm. And so the opposite would be, I can be inspired, maybe I can tweak, adapt, maybe I can use the same principle, and if it doesn't work, maybe I can try something else later.
Yeah, it's worth a try. I'm going to adapt, I'm going to bring it, I'm going to bring this idea into my classroom, and I'm going to make it work in my classroom. If it doesn't work, I'll change it further and make it work the next time around. Because Carol Dweck, Dweck has the not yet. It didn't work yet, but it probably will work next week or a little later in the day or in the next learning episode. So that's the right idea. Planning from a growth mindset point of view. Okay, can we go to this table here? What was your, was it a planning action? Was it
a teaching action.
A teaching action, yeah. Great.
I think in a lot of Chinese classrooms, when a student makes a mistake, the teacher still says, very good, because they produced something that sounded like Chinese.
Yep, okay.
But if success is its own reward, and success is accurate production, then in a growth mindset classroom, the student should want accurate feedback and feel even better when the teacher says, you're right this time.
Uh-huh. And you're right because you did this and this and this. You're praising the strategy. You really engage and you picked, you know, you employed the right strategy to solve this problem and to learn this particular concept or achieve this particular task. You're praising that effort. And that's what students like to hear. Very good. Your action here, is it a teaching, is it a planning, or is it an assessment?
As a teacher, I would always feel that walking into a classroom, the teacher always has this growth mindset that she's going to be teaching in a way that the student can understand, and if they don't, then she can modify and improving on her learning plans to make sure that the child can be able to understand what you're trying to teach. So
that's the culture that you want to establish in your program. You want every teacher in your program that believes that every single student, my lessons and my students, are going to come together and they are going to benefit from my planning, my teaching, and my assessment strategies. That's the culture we want to establish in every Star Talk program. That's the belief. Rather than, oh, we cannot teach this or we cannot teach that because.
Perfect. Whether you teach a language or anything, any subject, you walk into a classroom with that.
You have to believe that. Yeah. We wish that would occur in every instance. It doesn't automatically. And for those of us who do not have that going for us, we need to deliberately plan it as part of our professional development process in our program. You know, if you already have it and you have your team is already there, perfectly. But if you don't have it, we really need to develop a way of infusing this idea, building this culture that all of my teachers, all of my stakeholders in my program are going to believe that we are going to be successful and we're going to do everything possible. Our effort is going to be all geared towards, you know, every student succeeding in this program. This table here?
Yes, this is an action.
Uh-huh. A teaching action, uh-huh.
Yes, and for Arabic, for example, a traditional attitude would say that there are a number of sounds in the Arabic alphabet, like ba,
impossible,
like ha, like kha, like da, and most students are going to end up programmed without being able to excel in those. Uh-huh. And so that's the
fixed mindset.
So if we were to start with an attitude to students that they should be capable at the end, mm-hmm. and that we can even show them examples of non-native speakers of Arabic who have reached that, sure. and do the necessary scaffolding, it will be the case that they will mostly approximate those step by step. Yeah.
Yes. At the beginning, not yet, but you know that by the end of the program, in the middle of the program, they are going to be achieved. And that's your, say, it's not quite there, but instead of saying, you did it wrong again. But don't worry, you're never going to get it. Okay. You are saying, oh, you're almost there. Yeah, I bet by, you know, next week you'll be able to pronounce that sound and it will sound just like a native speaker. Okay, let's continue to, you know, look to all of our videos and all of our language models for how we can really, really acquire that sound and make it sound as close as possible too. Okay, good job. We all have great strategies for infusing this. We already did the sharing here. Okay, how do we connect the concepts of growth, of a growth mindset to the Star Talk principles? Because the Star Talk principles are our guiding principles for our program development, our curriculum template development. Everything we do needs to connect back to the Star Talk principles. They embody our entire program, our entire effort in the Star Talk culture here. Now, we need now, we have this growth mindset philosophy of really, you know, instilling in everyone, in all of our stakeholders, in all of our students, in the program, how do we go about in instilling that at the curriculum template development? Because let's have this in mind as we're developing the curriculum template. Our professional development that we are going to conduct prior to our program or during our program, and the planning, teaching, and assessing experiences that we are going to plan for our students. And most importantly, at the end of the day, when you hold those reflection sessions, or at the end of the week, and whenever you hold them, you want the growth mindset to be your guiding principle. Because if we're coming into that room, and we're going to be looking back at that lesson, we definitely want to have a growth mindset for addressing any challenge that we may have faced during the day or during the week and say, how are we going to get there since we probably did not achieve everything we needed to achieve. It's not yet there, but we are going to be able to achieve it in the future. So we really need to do this. We're going to try activity two here, and we're going to have you in groups of three or four. Well, let's stay with tables because we're small groups here. We are going to, from whatever role you want to take this on, some of you are program directors, some of you are team leaders, some of you are instructors in the program, whatever role you wish to play here, you are going to look at the Star Talk. You're going to choose one per table, only one principle. You have the element of choice here, and you are going to identify the target audience, whoever you're going to be working with. If you're a team leader, you're probably going to be working with the director.
Would you mind coming
if you
here
are
to join the group?
A lead teacher, you're probably going to be working with your other colleagues.
Thank you.
Instructors in the program. The teachers are going to be working with their students.
Yeah,
you may be working with the school community. Whatever the target audience is here. And you are going to look at that learning principle, and you're going to give it sort of a mindset context. How you are going to translate that principle now with a growth mindset in place. Just pick any principle from the list. The one you... Yeah. Just do one per table, okay? One per table. Okay, we're going to bring this to a closure. We know you're not quite finished. We'll start with this table with the sharing to make it easier on our helpers here. In sharing back, name the principal that you've chosen, the target audience, who you'd be working with, and then what the fixed mindset would be, and then the growth mindset in approaching that. Who's going to be the reporter here? Okay. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
So we have 60 integrated content and language.
Uh-huh.
In a global language puzzle.
So integrated language, content, and culture is the principle you're going to be working with. Go ahead.
And the target audience will be teachers.
Uh-huh. Teachers in a program.
The program and the school children. Mm-hmm. School, not the university, but the learners. Fixed mindset will be like, we're teaching the culture and language, but, how to bring in the content and integrate that.
Yeah.
And the growth mindset, I guess, it's the idea is to break down the content into smaller pieces and then try to bring in some content, which is based on your team.
Uh-huh.
So team provides the content.
Mm-hmm.
And I was giving an example, like last year I had the team of food,
healthy
food.
Uh-huh.
So there's culture and there's content. They learn about the names of the foods, mm-hmm, and vegetables.
Nutrition and all that.
And actually, based on the theme, can bring in the content and culture.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you're teaching the language.
So the fixed mindset will be basically, well, all we can do is teach the language and the culture. But the content will be too hard because it's concepts, it's information that students will not be able to understand. But with the growth mindset, you say, we can teach the content. Students can get something besides the language and the cultural setting here. They actually can get information, in your case, nutritional information, that will be beneficial and it's real world, it's purposeful for them to use in the real world and outside of the classroom. It's language. It's content and language and culture that will be useful as they begin to plan their diets and pay attention to what they're eating and so forth and so on. Perfect. Wonderful. Thank you. This table here, what was the principle we went for?
First we have to vote about who's going to...
exactly, the reporter. Go ahead.
We did using the target language and providing comprehensible input and instruction. For
okay.
Target audience, students in high school.
Uh-huh.
One of the things we talked about was in a fixed mindset environment, teachers may say, our students can't be in an immersive environment if they haven't already learned some of the language. There's true beginners.
Exactly.
But the growth mindset, you come at it and say, as long as you do it in a conscious sequence with manageable chunks, students can do it.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things we talked about.
Perfect, I'm sure. That's what we all do, okay? So you shift it, it can be done, with students with minimum language if you, you know, use the right approaches and the right strategies, okay? And then the last table here, which principle did we pick here?
We chose facilitating that learner-centered classroom and uh-huh. overlap some of the things. So the students, the targeted audience is students, uh-huh. learners in high school level, uh-huh. novice. Mm-hmm. And so the fixed mindset, I know everything, you know nothing, so I am the one who's the expert, I am the one who knows all of the language and have never taken the language, so I'm going to teach you everything.
I will be in control of this class and I deliver the language and everything else that they need to know.
Do everything I say to get a grade that you want. You cannot possibly use the target language because I'm the one who knows it. Uh-huh. So don't leave language. Until
you can do it perfectly like me.
Right.
Okay?
So the growth mindset would be from the know-nothing to, we use an analogy that Alida and Mulder have used about if you're a parent, you don't ever tell your baby, I'm not going to talk to you because you don't know the language. You always talk. From the beginning, mm-hmm. you're always talking, and you know they don't understand everything, but you're mm-hmm. always exposing them to that language. Mm-hmm. And if you have more than one children, you know that they all are going to be, their development in language will be different. For the other one, for the grade, instead of focusing on, oh, you're going to get this grade, you're going to focus on growth and progress, on reflecting how yeah. you're doing.
And you believe in all the research that tells us that students, that silent period is an important period of language acquisition. You continue talking, you continue with your input, and you know that students will be ready to respond at the appropriate time.
And we also talked about the variety of activities that it would be student-led, so having a balance between teacher, instructor-led, student-led activities.
Mm. Wow. Perfect. We are all on our way to becoming the growth mindset instructors and program directors and teacher leaders, because we all need to grow in this process of becoming a growth mindset kind of leaders in the StarTalk program. We believe that we have been employing the growth mindset in our StarTalk programs in almost everything we do. And here's what we have learned to be the successful features that we look back at the end of our program in our reflection sessions and so forth, that is a result of us believing in a growth mindset and also leads to our programs being successful in equipping students with the language skills, with the cultural abilities, the cultural competence that they need to go out in the community and interact with heritage speakers, native speakers of the language, and feel successful. Teaching in the target language and employing immersion-like situations. The more you bathe the students in the language, the more they acquire, the more they feel successful in surviving in those contexts. If you do not provide those opportunities in the classroom for them to be totally surrounded by language and culture in multiple ways, throughout the day, they probably will say, well, I cannot survive without my teacher using English, or with my textbook, or whatever other things we put in their way. We really believe that really immersing the students in that language and culture and having them feel comfortable and safe in that environment then extends to the real world here. We also believe deeply in team teaching approaches to supporting our students. All of our teachers can step into any of the classrooms at any given time and know exactly where the students are and where to take them to the next level. I think the team teaching approach is critical here, the team planning, the team teaching, and if you can instill this in your program and have, maybe I would even venture in having some of the teachers teach one group of students today and another group of students tomorrow. Because we need to know different learners. And we all the students need to see all the teachers in the program as a source of language and culture and someone who can support them in that language process. So I really think the more everyone knows about what's going on in every classroom, the more we know our students and our language learners, the more our students will benefit from that experience. Having one language model is not always the best for our students to learn the particular language. In our program, we always have at least two teachers in the classroom, because we really believe that team teaching approach, someone is always tending to the student needs. The other thing we bring in past StarTalk students to be role models for our language learners. And I believe that has made such a big difference in our StarTalk programs. First of all, an empowering experience for those students that are invited back. Talking about the growth mindset, those students just excel. They learn so much more. And it's the students that are, you know, the primary participants in the program love learning from their peers. They really build a strong relationship. First of all, when the students, you know, introduce themselves and say, I was a student in this program last year, and here's what I learned. And every time the teachers, you know, are framing a particular learning episode, they always rely on those students to go up first and model what they want the students to do. So the students immediately get, you know, reinforcement of what the teacher is asking them to do for that particular time. So team teaching, extended teaching, having more and more in language models in the classroom is a great, great way of engaging all learners in the process. At the end of the program, the students who play the role models in the classroom, they feel like that they have acquired so much more the second time around in the curriculum, because we never do the same thing twice, as you probably don't do in your program. And I really think another strength of a program is those joint reflection sessions. We spend about an hour every day after our program ends and reflecting about every single minute what took place in the classroom, and talking and dialoguing with each other. And of course, the two team teachers that were in one classroom, but also talking across classrooms. Because, in my classroom, when I did this activity, this happened. But in our classroom, our students were not responding well too. So we analyze all that, reflect jointly, and then that's the point of departing for adjusting the lesson for the next day. And we record our reflections, we record our challenges, we record our successes, and say, okay, how can we improve on the lesson plan we already have written for tomorrow? How can we adjust it? How can we reinforce all the things we want to do tomorrow in order to make it even a better learning experience for the students and also for us as teachers here? Did I go backwards?
No.
Okay. I already covered that one. This group got it. You know, that's the principle that you hit on. Learner-center activities is what it's at. I have to tell you, our students are the happiest when they are creating and when they are producing products, which goes right into the next one. We really, really try hard for our students to do create a lot of products that illustrates what they know and are able to do with the language and the culture. And I really think I would encourage you to do as much of this as possible in your program. And assessment. And Peggy is an expert at assessment here. I always look to Peggy for assessment. The more ways you can set up, the more tasks you can set up for students to demonstrate what they know and are able to do, the more successful the students are going. They love options to demonstrate what they know and are able to do. So don't just settle for one assessment option, for one check for learning. Have different formats, different ways that students can express what they know and are able to do, because they are gonna feel so much more accomplished here. I already talked about involving different stakeholders. We bring in a lot of community folks to help us with some cultural activities. They are wonderful models for providing and supporting our students. And they go out and they feel so inspired for what they see students wanting to learn what they have to offer in their language and culture. So involve the community as much as possible. And we involve our parents and involve members of the school community. Our program happens to be integrated in a summer school program. And the summer school program has a lot more going on. It's a summer school for mathematics, English, language arts, history, social science. But we really enjoy integrating our program and bringing other folks into our program. We also bring in some teacher candidates. We have them in the summer at Stanford. So we bring them in to first observe and then begin to co-plan and co-teach some of the learning activities, the learning episodes with our teachers. And the last bullet is, it's so critical that we understand what our students are going to be doing beyond our Star Talk program. So we need to know where they're going to go in the fall, either at the middle school, for in our case, or the high school. So we can, front load our learning experience and address those challenges that we think they are going to be facing in the level one or the level two Chinese program, in our case, where they're going to go. So the more we can articulate our program to be that sort of front piece or the preamble to their fall learning experience, I think that supports the students. And like I said, students arrive as confident learners at the end of the whole process. This is probably the most challenging, and it goes to the principle of differentiation. We really need to pitch our instruction to meet our learners where they are, no matter where they are in that language learning continuum. Even if we think we're doing a program for beginning students, after day one, everyone is at a different level. We need to understand that. After day two, everyone is going to be at a different level. And we need to be mindful of where the students, which students are at whatever level, and begin to doing some grouping according to where we believe they are. So it takes a lot of observation. And that's why I believe in team teaching, because in team teaching, when one teacher is teaching, the other one is observing where the students are and saying, oh, I really believe we need to do an extra activity with this group of students here so they can internalize that concept, so they are able to do the learning episode number 3 and do the task we have planned there, because I believe that X student and Y student needs a little bit more reinforcement in the language or in the writing, process, or whatever the interpretive activity is, because he or she is not understanding everything. And it's been stressed here all along is the checks for learning, because it's critical that at every level of the process, and that what two teachers can do even more so is saying, we really need to do another check for learning here. We really need to do this type of check for learning, because there's different models all the time. If you went to the required presentation yesterday for students, you saw that the diverse ways of doing checks for learning. And you need to have all that in your repertoire and choose and select the appropriate one for that particular point and time in your learning episode. These are all the things that we sort of gather as a result of working collaboratively to make the learning experience as effective as it possibly can be for our students. Always having the growth mindset that if we do these things, our students will succeed. That's sort of like our driving principle here. Okay. I've said almost everything that is here already. We don't need to spend a lot of time here, but it sort of summarizes everything that I have said before. And probably the most important piece here in a growth mindset is relating their performance to their level of effort. We explicitly need to say, you succeeded here, you did very well here because you put a lot of effort into it. Praise the effort. Always praise the effort here for the students. Okay, so planting the seeds of growth, mindset, and a curriculum template. That's our immediate task for us, right? We're all gonna go home and our first task here is gonna be doing stage 1, stage 2, get that approved, and then move on to stage 3. And we have an activity here that we are going to be describing for you, and then have you engage in it to go ahead and do it. Are you going to introduce it? Go ahead. Okay. So in pairs or by tables, let's do this by tables, we're small. Please conceptualize one growth mindset leadership action that you plan to integrate in one of the three stages of your curriculum template development process. Record your actions in the task sheet. Be ready to share your leadership actions. So you're gonna do either stage one, stage two, or stage three. Pick one per table. You can't do all of them. We don't have enough time. And then you're gonna go back and conceptualize at least one growth mindset leadership activity that you would engage in. Because the curriculum template, we need to instill this right from the curriculum template. It needs to have this as a guiding principle. Okay? Just pick the stage and one of the activities that you would select. Okay, we're running a little bit out of time. I'm gonna stop you right here in the process. Let's have this table share because the microphone is right here, okay? Okay, did you pick a stage?
Yes, we have picked the stage.
Okay.
The stage that we have picked is stage one, obviously, because we did not want to start with stage two.
And three, and you cannot do stage three yet.
So we talked about the actual performance of clients, and those can do stages.
Uh-huh.
If we make students aware, first of all, that of what those performance objectives are, then that is going to be a growth mindset. They know at the very beginning of the day that
where they need to go.
And then we said also that in the end, when we are done and when we have done the learning checks, students are going to be able to say, oh yes, you told us in the beginning that we were going to do this. Now we have the demonstrations. Mm-hmm. So there is firm evidence that we have been able to do this.
Uh-huh.
Our colleagues add also that when we give them a chance to reflect upon it, the reflection action itself is very empowering and it's a mode of growth.
It's motivational for them.
Mm-hmm. It just makes them really write down.
Mm-hmm.
They become aware that they have done this and they document it.
Uh-huh.
And lastly, perhaps we will tell them that it is possible that they may not have reached the end of this or the full performance competent for full performance, but they are on the way to.
Within that context?
Words, not yet thing, not yeah. yet fully, yeah. but we're, it's an approximation.
They met the performance goal there,
yes.
you know, for that particular context.
And they're moving along.
Uh-huh. Perfect. Okay, let's just capture, that group is gonna share, is that what I heard? Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So we pick up the stage two, how will the participant demonstrate competence? One thing we can do is develop the various assessment tools, tests, based on students, they are different, learning progress, they are different stage
mm-hmm.
to differentiate their
product, whatever they're going to produce.
Uh-huh.
Go ahead.
And I think the various ways of assessment, including formative and summative. Mm-hmm. And formative would be the like as a sleep and checking for understanding, quick write, quick draw. Use a variety of web, four corners, getting up, interact, and summative would be to produce whatever the goal is. Also, mm-hmm. I don't know, four functions of the
yeah.
and multiple intelligence.
Yeah, and that process alone of checking for learning and students being able to demonstrate how far they are getting in that continuum of where they need to go, that in itself is validating and provides a growth mindset. I am on my way to learning what I'm supposed to be learning today. Okay, that's the feedback that students need. And of course, you're praising them all along for their effort and everything else. We're gonna skip that table, but because of the interest of time, and we're just gonna move on.
Nothing personal
at all. Sorry.
There were more opportunities.
Okay. We in our program, our theme is Silk Road Ambassadors. And we love this theme because it's very engaging for our middle school students because they take a very active role in becoming the Silk Road ambassadors. We include in our program four countries, all traders on the Silk Road, China, of course, and India, and Italy, and Egypt, okay? So our students, you know, learn about all the merchants on the Silk Road, what they brought, how they came, their mode of transportation on the Silk Road, what they were trading on the Silk Road, and so forth. Their role on the Silk Road is to sell the Chinese language and cultural products. That's what they go on the Silk Road. So they have to learn the language and they have to, you know, create a lot of the products in order to go and sell to the other merchants, to the representatives of Egypt and India and Italy on the Silk Road. So they have a lot of fun with this and they know that they have to have all these things. They know that they have to learn in order to, you know, have meaningful communicative interchanges with the other merchants. But we have learned that from the curriculum template to the learning plan, it's too big of a jump. It's too big of a jump. So we have created, I think we just shared it with you, what we call sort of a pacing guide, and we break that curriculum template much further down into sub-themes as well. We have like a different sub-theme for each week, and then every single day we break it down. The teachers can talk more about that, but it's really, really critical because this document to us becomes our working curriculum template. To be honest with you, our curriculum template doesn't become very visible after we complete it and we complete this document, you know. And of course it changes every year because we change our curriculum template every year. But after we do the curriculum template and it's approved by our team leader, we engage in this process here. And I have to tell you, this is extremely, extremely helpful to us. It may not be to you, okay? It may not be to your instructors, but to us, and I think you wanna do a testimonial? what it does? Go ahead.
Yeah, I think it really helps because when you have so much to teach in only 4 weeks, you really need to put every piece into it's like a puzzle. Mm-hmm. You want to put them in the right place to get the big picture finished. And this is actually what we do after the summer. We do like lesson, everyday lesson plannings here. But the roadmap is there. So we know, okay, we want to teach these many functions and we cannot teach in 1 week. So we move this here, we move this here, and this is the vocab we're going to teach for this week, how we can combine the functions with, you know, even the culture, everything, how do we balance. So that takes a lot of time too.
Yeah. But I have to tell you, it's a very valuable exercise, and we thought we would share it with you. Yes, they just refer to, basically, this is sort of like our lesson plans backed up with student products. And it's really, really something that we look back a lot when we're writing this year's curriculum template. We go back here, and this is so informative for us because it has all the lesson plans from last year and what the students were able to produce. And believe it or not, at least I forget the kinds of product that our students, you know, produced last year as a result of X lesson plan and Y lesson plan. So we use this tool a lot to develop this year's curriculum template, as well then also use it when we go back and say, let's really look at, you know, what the students were able to produce as a result of this activity. And we look at it and sometimes say, wow, they really exceeded our expectation, and said, well, they didn't quite get there. You know, I think we can go a little further here. What can we do here? How can we map it out a little further in order to get them to where we really would like them to be? So these two tools become critical and essential planning tools for the next year. Use it if it's useful to you, and if it's not useful to you, just leave it behind and don't use it. To us, it's our intermediate step, and it's not a requirement. It's not start talking door. It's our own internal tool for survival, I guess, because it's really hard for us. It's really hard to go from that curriculum template to not having something as specific, you know, on a daily basis. And even our themes, because we know exactly what we need to cover within that theme becomes a little, it gives it a twist for the week. You know, Silk Road Ambassadors is the overall theme, but we pick those very specific themes that we try to emphasize. Yes, okay. So basically, failure is an opportunity to grow. It's critical that we understand that process. Don't be too dismayed and too concerned when your students fail or your lesson plan doesn't quite get there, because every time, if you look at it from a growth mindset, it's an opportunity to learn, it's an opportunity to explore new avenues and new ways of doing things. I'm gonna move rather quickly. We're not gonna do this activity, but I don't know if you have this problem, and you probably don't, but let's share the handout here, and you'll have the PowerPoint here because it's gonna be posted. But some of us sometimes have to do some unlearning, and if you have some members in your team that may not be as familiar with the growth mindset and tend to, you know, think a little bit negative, this tool is designed to help your whole team to develop a growth mindset. If you need to work in your professional development with your team to say, I want to make sure that everyone is on the same page as I am with a growth mindset, this was a tool designed that we're going to do an activity with you to help you do that. You may not need it. Everybody may already be there, but if you need it, go ahead and use it. And I am sorry we're not going to be able to do this. We were going to apply it either to do the curriculum template, your professional development, your learning experiences, or your performance and feedback. Okay, I'm going to turn it over to my friend Claire over there, because I said earlier that our reflection process every day of about an hour is really the critical aspect of our program. And what we do and work very hard is to frame the questions that will lead that process every day. So at the end of today, we would frame the question we would deal with tomorrow. And Claire is going to lead us in that process of how we frame the questions and how we approach them. Claire, it's yours.
Yeah. Here are some questions that we proposed to you. You might find them useful, and we encourage you to implement some of them in your program reflection. As Dewart mentioned, we reflect every day, and that's the core of our program. I think make us stronger. And because we do that, we create a safe space, and we find out everybody is more risk-taking, and we identify openly our strength and some areas to improve. So the first question is, what are some struggles that we are experiencing in teaching the target language and culture? So these are some questions might lead you to think how you would implement them and what kind of product it may yield, and how would you know the learning objective has been succeeded? And if there's a need to change the school cultures, how would you address them? So we don't have time to allow you to volunteer sharing, but just think on your own. The next question is, how can we model the best practice to ourselves and our students? This is the core of reflection. My next one is, how do we create a culture of trust and collaboration for exploring new ideas and inspiring confidence to generate new knowledge? So considering the students' outcome, how would you know that? And next one is, how can our StarTalk program focus on dynamic learning environment that are not associated with success or failure mindset, and allow us for reflection on what we have learned from the process? Again, the idea, both for the teacher community and student community, is not about fail or succeed. It's what do we learn from that? What kind of strategy or perseverance we learn from the process? The last one, we proposed the question, how can our StarTalk program shift its overall assessment practice from summative to formative and become a more relevant factor of every stakeholder daily practice. So I hope these questions will give you some implication or some ideas just to think about whether you want to take summative or informative or both approach. So we, again, these are proposed questions, and feel free to develop more. Our core is we want to encourage every program have a reflection session embedded. Yeah, question?
Thank you, Claire. Yeah,
thank you.
Any questions? Sorry, we ran out of time.
Thank you.
Thank you. People went lunch. Any questions? Yes.
When you co-teach, build up the trust is very important.
Absolutely.
And do you do before the summer camp, do you group teacher together, and how activity do you do?
He took us to retreat.
we spend a lot of time and doing the joint planning and building trust. You need to have trust. And our teachers feel extremely comfortable in exploring their deepest issues, their deepest challenges in that context, and say, I just do not know how to approach this. We need to work together. You know, somebody here needs to support me on how to approach this. None of us have the answers to every single aspect of our teaching and our planning processes. But collectively, we're smart. I have to tell you, our teacher candidates bail us out. You know, we include them in our reflection process. And they come in with fresh minds in different ways. He said, have you considered, because they're sitting in that classroom and they're almost learners as the students are, have you considered doing this and this and this? They said, we haven't, but we will, because with our growth mindset. So you need to build a lot of trust in your, you know, community, and it's everyone. It's the project director, the lead instructor, all the instructors together, because everyone has something equally valuable to contribute to that community. And once you believe that, you're no longer threatened by anyone saying, oh my God, I hope anybody did not notice what I just did, or that I was not able to do that well. No, I didn't quite do that as well as I could, but I know that with some help from you, I can do it better tomorrow or the next week and so forth. Not yet. But it's a work in progress here. But I agree with you, you need to build a lot of trust. Absolutely, yes.
I'm sorry, how do you honor the different teaching styles?
That is a strength. That is a strength, and that's the reason team teaching is absolutely great. And because we don't pair teachers because they are alike or think alike. We pair teachers because they are diverse in their thinking and in their strategies, and in their beliefs, and their approaches. Secondary, elementary, immersion, high school. They couldn't be further apart, but you know, that's what it is. Because when you group teachers that think alike, they're probably not gonna grow, because they're not gonna question each other as much. But look what an immersion teacher can bring to a high school teacher, which teaches in a completely different context. And look what a high school teacher can bring to an immersion teacher, because it's providing, you know, a different perspective for addressing a completely different student at a different developmental level. And you know, in middle school, we have all developmental levels going on in your classroom. You have the very immature, young students that need that elementary teacher and sort of like, somebody very nurturing. And then you have those guys that come in and they know it all. And you need the high school teacher that say, okay, I can handle this. I handle this every day in my classroom. If you're teaching middle school, you need everyone in that community. So don't pair your teachers by how well they get along or teach alike. But what you need to have is deep respect for each other. You need to be able to say, this teacher brings something unique to my teaching experience, and I also have something to offer to that teacher. So mutual respect is a key here. So think about that when you're putting your teams together. Don't just associate yourself with the people that think like you, because you're probably not gonna grow in that process. You need people that will challenge you and say, God, we could have done that so much better. Or we can do this so much better if you're at the planning stage. And that's what these teachers do every day so well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And sorry, go grab your lunch.
Thank you for taking your lunch time.
Thank you for the team.